This is Dennis Ramundi. I'm here with my co-host, Phil Goldberg, author of American Veda. Our show, Spirit Matters Talk, spiritmatterstalk.com, is where our podcast can be found. Our guest today, Dr. Naheed Angha. She is a Sufi scholar, human rights activist, women's rights activist, lecturer, translator, and author of over 15 published books. She is the co-director and co-founder of the International Association of Sufism, and founder of the International Sufi Women Organization, and the executive director of the online journal Sufism. Dr. Angha, thank you so very much for taking the time to come on our podcast today.
Well, thank you so much for the invitation.
Naheed, if we may call you that. This is, I think, an opportunity for us to inform our listeners about Sufism and its relation to the larger scope of Islam. For those who are unfamiliar with Sufism, or for whom the word Sufism or Sufi is just associated with Rumi and whirling dervishes, perhaps you can give us an overview of what Sufism is and how it fits into the historical picture of Islam.
Sufism... But before I go to Sufism, almost all religions or all faith traditions do have some spiritual schools within themselves. So other than just listening and doing whatever is on the surface and on the discipline and on the principles, there are some people who would like to actually get to the meaning of all those terms and practices that we do. In Islam, the mystical path of Islam is Sufism. So Sufism comes from the heart of Islam and goes back to the time of the Prophet of Islam, 7th century. And on the first Muslim mosque that he built close to his house in Medina, there were a group of people coming from different nationalities. They were not all Arabs. They were from different nationalities. They used to come to that mosque and sit on the platform of his mosque, and they would ask questions such as, you are talking about God, so are you the only one who has the experience of this God, or is that experience is open to all human beings? And if it is open to all human beings, so how would I, a personal human being, individual human being, would be able to experience that sacred divinity? So since they were sitting on that platform, they were called Ahl Sufi, the people of the platform. Over time, after the passing of the Prophet, many of these people went back to their own homeland, and they began to teach whatever they have learned. And for those understanding, they began to create the principles of meditation and purification and remembrance and everything that would help a human being to come to that point of concentration, to understand or to attune himself or herself to receive those spiritual waves. So Sufism comes back to 7th century to Medina at the time of the Prophet, to a group of people who gradually over time they were called Sufis. And there are many explanations of Sufis, like they were the people of, you know, the Ahl Sufi, the people of the platform, or the people who used to wear wooden, robe, and so many different assumptions. Ultimately, there is no root word for this word, for the word Sufi. I was looking into some of the old texts, and I actually found some of the references to the word Sufi that in Persian and in Arabic language is tasawwuf, and ultimately it came to an understanding that tasawwuf is a combination of four letters, and each one of these letters introduced three different principles. So that became tasawwuf, and that became a root for the Sufism. Otherwise, Sufism does not have any root word in either Persian or Arabic language.
Naheed, I wanted to ask you, within the practice of, within Sufism, as you mentioned before, it's sort of a mystical religion or a mystical part of Islam. So you have, as I understand it, techniques that are practiced to give somebody a deeper mystical experience. What are some of those techniques that you practice, and what is the goal of those techniques?
In my personal view, because, mm-hmm. We have to remember that Islam is a very individualistic religion. That is why we do not have any special center that all Muslims would, receive their instructions from that center. So my own personal understanding is ultimately all creations, everything that we call creation and probably science calls universe or beings, we have some connection, some fixed point that creates all these manifestations. The goal of a Sufi is to attune himself or herself to ultimately connect to that essence that connects us all. And according to the slogan of Islam, there is nothing except that there is that divine reality and that divine unity, and ultimately all beings are a part of that divine unity. For me, is to understand what is that divinity within me. And for that, there are practices of meditation, and there are practices of remembrance and purifications. And the most important of all these practices is meditation. Yeah. And one thing that I have to mention is that Sufi meditation is heart meditation, not mind meditation.
Mm-hmm. Can you explain that a little further, Naheed, when you say heart meditation?
Yes. The reason of, if we pay attention to our own physical system, there are two major centers that attract all kinds of waves, energies, our brain activities and our heart activities. And we pay so much attention to our brain and so much attention to our perceptions and mind activities, even though everything ultimately leads to brain somehow. But Sufis began to think about the first organ that develops in human being is the heart. And ultimately, the organ that dies out is the heart. It means that people can live with brain dead, but nobody can live without heart dead. Ultimately, the organ that comes to life first and ends life last is the heart. So they began to think that there must be some important message within this organ. So that is the connections of before and connections of after, and it holds an important value by itself. So one of the practices of heart meditation is that gathering all your energies and ultimately bringing your energies toward your chest and toward your heart. And the very first very introductory practice is to listen to your heartbeat. It means that ultimately we have to recognize where the heart is. And we pay attention. We teach our system to ultimately focus in the heart. Now, sometimes we think meditation is like relaxation and being in a peaceful place, which of course is. But in Sufism, it's concentrations of energies and bringing everything toward your chest and ultimately concentrate all your energies toward your heart. And another important matter is that when we concentrate our energies, we develop certain kind of electromagnetic atmosphere around ourselves. And since we practice to gather all the energies that are spiritual, so what you ultimately would receive would be spiritual waves. And I was thinking about that quite a long time ago when I was reading, so many different Sufi histories and biographies and teachings. And I realized that ultimately, sometimes we may think that revelations and inspirations is something that happens to some, certain people, and maybe it is not really factual. But in reality, when you concentrate all your energies, you do create electromagnetic systems around yourself, and you become a receiver. A receiver not of all kinds of waves, but you would be the receiver of select waves that you attune in yourself. So one of the primary and very important practices in Sufism is meditation.
Okay. Naheed, also, when many of us think of Sufism, and maybe this is correct, maybe it's incorrect, we associate it with dance or a type of dance where the dancer gets up and spins. I think it's called the whirling dervish. And in that procedure, that a practice of dance that they're doing, they go very deeply inward. They have some type of mystical and inner experience. Is this another form of prayer or technique to accomplish what your meditation accomplishes as well?
If you remember, you know, in the history of Sufism, when all those, the students went back to their own homelands and they began to teach what they learned, what they have studied, over time, different schools of Sufism began to develop. And in some parts of the world, and one of the major Sufi centers that still exists was Persia, the present time Iran. So there are so many different Sufi schools that each one of these schools focus on one of the principles, most likely. There are Sufis that they are very in the state of, rapture and ecstasy. There are Sufis who are very intellectual and philosophical. There are some Sufis that they are meditative. There are Sufis who are on the social service, principle. So there are many different schools of Sufism has developed. One of the schools of Sufism is Mevlevi, that relates to Rumi. One of the practices of meditation and spiritual attunement to that divine energy is the whirling dervish. It is the whirling. It means that, you're turning around yourself. Not only you're turning like the earth around yourself, but also you are turning around the center, which is, in the case of Mevlevi Sufis, it is the teacher. And that is a very fascinating and very concentrated energy, receiving from divine and giving to the nature and to the human beings. It is a very concentrated practice, and that is a state of very deep meditation. But it is for one school of Sufism, not all schools of Sufism.
Right, and I think if I'm correct, your lineage is different from the one you just described. That's associated with Rumi. Can you tell us something of your lineage? And while you're at it, can you tell us? Were you born in Iran and came to the U.S. Later on?
Yes, I was born into a Sufi family. My father was a Sufi master, so I was born into Sufism. But I did not choose Sufism because I was born into Sufism. My father was a very open-minded, teacher. So he had many students, including his family. One of the things that did attract me to Sufism was that. The intensity of how much he knew a great deal of different sciences and different, not only spiritual, philosophical, scientific, and he became an embodiment of a universal mind to me. And I actually wanted to learn whatever he knew. That became my motivation in learning more about Sufism. The lineage that I come from is called Owaisi, and Owaisi relates to, again, back to the time of the Prophet, relates to a Sufi who was living in Yemen, and he was called Owais, and his style of practice was that he actually did not see the Prophet, eye to eye or in a physical sense, but he was inspired by his teachings. So the Owaisi style became a group of Sufis who were beginning to receive the teachings rather than receiving the presence of a physical teacher. So they began to learn from the, learning from the teachings of the Prophet, of teachings of these Sufi masters. Now, there are a group of people who are called Owaisis. And they are not in one any special kind of lineage, and some of them are in a special kind of lineage, like teacher to student, but a majority of them are not, because there is no assignment of anything in the OVC Sufism, and the principle of that school is that you receive your inspirations and teachings from the teaching of a teacher, rather than you're focusing around the physical presence of a teacher. You may have a physical presence of a teacher, and you may not have. But I was also educated in the United States. I was, sometimes I tell myself that I have gone through 60s twice. Once when I was studying here, it was, during the 60s times, and then when I go back to Iran, it was another 60s
right.
that I had experienced. And then we came to the United States in 78.
Okay, Nahia, can Sufi practitioners, members of your religion, can they practice openly in Islamic countries now, like Iran, or are they accepted or not?
Well, Sufism has been a great part of the Persian culture for a long, long time, since the beginning of its life, and there have been many Sufi masters that almost all Sufi masters or Sufi schools somehow relate themselves to the Persian Sufis. At the present time, the world is a very confusing place, so I really don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever you go, I'm not sure what is going on with people. It doesn't matter if you are a part of Sufism or not. In the world of chaos, actually, there is no special law. So I really don't know. That was the case in Persia, and many of the countries actually were welcoming Sufis for a long, long time. And I think still it is. Sometimes you hear conflicting ideas. I'm not sure if they have any factual basis to them or not. But Sufis have been very much welcomed all over the world, including the United States.
And also in India, I spent a lot of time in India, and there's a long tradition of Sufis and Sufis and Hindus and yogis coming together and actually borrowing practices from each other. And some of the great poets like Kabir and are of Sufi lineage. Most people, when they think of Islam and they know there are Sunnis and Shiites, but I think it's terribly important, and you probably do too, to let people know about the Sufi lineages of Islam, and which seem to be very much parallel to the esoteric or mystical traditions of other religions. People don't know much about them because it's sort of hidden and not as visible. You are involved with the International Association of Sufism, and could you tell us what the mission is and what the purpose of it is? It's obviously to let people know about Sufism.
Yes. Well, going to India, the main Sufi order that actually were gradually developed in India is the Chishti order. That they are beautiful musicians and poets. And one of the important things that we need to understand is that since Sufism, just like all the mystical paths, is so open to understanding, because ultimately it is not the frames and it is not the limited understanding that brings us to that essence of all that there is. So it is a feeling, especially that Sufism comes with its music and with the language of poetry. It becomes very appealing and is mingled with other traditions. So that is one of the reasons that Sufism has been welcome to many different cultures, because it does not come in a clash with cultures, but in attunement with cultures. And there are, of course, Shiites and Sunnis in Islam. Just like any other religions, there are different practices and there are different history to each one of these schools. There have been Sufis who are coming from the Sunni background, and there are Sufis who are coming from the Shiite background, but ultimately those names did dissolve itself into the world of Sufism, and at some point they became like Sufis rather than I'm a Sunni or I'm a Shiite.
Mm-hmm.
International Association of Sufism was established in 1983 in the United States. And the mission that we have, there are so many different schools of Sufism all around the world, and we are so much attuned and we are so much in love with our own practices that we hardly talk with one another, just like all the, you know, different religions. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you are a Jewish and if you are, of different background, if you are Christian of different backgrounds, you are so much attuned and focused on your own practice, and hardly you pay attention to others. The same thing happens, you know, it is universal, the stories. So we have decided to create an organization, regardless of all the schools of Sufism, so it does not have a title of this is from this school of Sufism. It is open to all Sufi schools. And we wanted to create a forum that invites all Sufis from different schools and all Sufi masters to a weekend of conversation. And we have been very successful. I was not sure when we began this story that it would actually happen. And actually it did happen. We began to invite Sufis from around the world, from all the way from Indonesia, all the way to West Africa. And they all came over time. So, and I thought that I would have 1 year of Sufism symposium. It lasted for 20 years.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Yes, and it lasted for 20 years. And, you know, and I remember on the 10th year, I was telling all these teachers that, you know, this is my, it is lots of hard work. And this would be the last year, and everybody told me that you cannot do this. You still have to continue. So we have created, established a forum for all Sufis to come to conversation with one another. And we have been very successful in that. Mm-hmm. And over time, we have created an actual international Sufi family. Mm-hmm. Last year, we have published a book of all these Sufis who came together in that spirit of friendship and harmony, and we published that book, and it's called Caravan. And I think in there we have the biographies of almost 200 Sufis of the present time.
Nahida, you are the founder of the Sufi Women's Organization.
Yes.
And
yes.
Part of what the Sufi Women's Organization does is it advocates for women's and children's rights. Tell us about that.
Well, over time we became, you know, NGO of the Department of Public Information of the United Nations. So we were able to, you know, give lectures and participate in some of the decision makings. Not that we were decision makers, but, you know, we would be able to listen and see what was going on. And that was 92. And in 92, we began to, invite again. We began with Sufi women from around the world, but gradually changed to women, whoever was open, to come together. And we created a code of ethics all together. It took us about 8 months. And then gradually we began to pick, you know, organizations who are on the women's, they contribute to the women's rights or you know, advocates for women's rights and children. And we began to work with them, disseminate their information, financial support to them, and take active participation in some of the projects that they have. And so we have been supporting refugees in sub-Sahara, providing immunization, clean water, education, supplies, and for the last, I think it's like 15, mm-hmm. 16, or 20 years.
The way the world is now, there's a lot of attention on Islam. Some of it is sympathetic, and much of it is antagonistic. Is part of your mission to educate the larger world, the people who are the non-Islamic world, on the Sufi interpretation of Islam and of the Quran, and to sort of correct misperceptions of Islam that exist?
Well, there are a few things that I would like to mention. One is that, first of all, there is no religion or faith tradition in the world that I know of that had not created violence against other people.
Right.
So none of us is innocent of anything. That is the first thing.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout history, we have seen that. And the reason is that religion or faith tradition is such an, or probably the only most powerful agent that we can use. We may be a part of this political system, that political system, but ultimately, almost all of us, the entire world, is a part of a religion. So religion becomes such a powerful agent, and not always self-serving, not always serving humanity, most likely mm-hmm. self-serving. That is one thing. Second is that the biggest confusion is that we always sacrifice the bigger story for smaller stories. For the, probably the population of the world, I think probably is like 6-7 billion people, and Islam is the second largest. So all these billions of people, suddenly they are hijacked by the story of a few hundred thousand people. So that creates some kind of animosity, and actually it becomes a label to the religion. That is something that needs education. There are political systems, and each political system serves under whatever that serves. We create an ideology, and that ideology is sellable. We can sell to the nations, and we use that ideology for our own ambition. That is something that we have to understand. First of all, no religion is innocent. Second is that why we are letting a group of people who hijack the religion, we let them hijack the religion. So in reality, it is not that a group of people are hijacking a religion. We let them hijack the religion mm-hmm. because we also let them create such a negative and such a violent portrait of a religion that is peaceful.
Mm-hmm. Naheed, getting back to the mystical side of Sufism, do you, in your own daily life, practice your meditation every day, or is it a big part of your daily routine?
Yes, of course, I meditate, whenever I can, and most of the time during the night time,
mm-hmm.
I meditate. And, over time, it becomes, whatever you practice, and I think it's true for every human being, whatever becomes the focus of our life becomes our life. So it doesn't matter that if you are sitting, 2 hours for meditation or not, ultimately it becomes your lifestyle. And one of the practices in Sufism is that you have to teach by your own example. All Sufis somehow are a part of community service programs, and they, once you learn, you become responsible to honor humanity, to serve humanity, and so that also is a practice. It means that, I am receiving from this bounty of the universe. I take as much as I need, not more than that.
Mm-hmm.
As a sign of appreciation to whatever you receive, you also serve the greater cause. So I meditate, and I'm always, contributing and serving.
Naheed, if people think of a spiritual practice they associate with Sufism, in addition to whirling dervishes, which we already mentioned, some people know the term dhikr, if I'm pronouncing it correctly. Can you explain that? Because people, especially if they've gone to interfaith gatherings, or they may have been exposed to dhikr. Can you explain what that is and the varieties of it?
Yes. Zikr itself means remembrance.
Mm.
And the majority of the Sufis, you sit in a circle, and most of the Sufis sit on the floor. You sit on a circle, and you begin to chant. And you chant the names of God, or most of the Sufis use the chanting of La ilaha illallah, means that there is no limited self. All that there is the divine presence. And they chant it, different Sufis chant this phrase, 100 times, sometimes 110 times, sometimes more than that. So that is a remembrance. But remembrance has a very profound meaning in Sufism. One is the, you know, open, you know, remembrance, which is that chanting, a zikr that people sit and chant. And then gradually, you know, people would receive private chanting. They would receive a name that they chant between themselves, and it becomes a part of their meditation. Zikr means the remembrance.
Very
and remembrance of thought.
Nahid, thank you so very much for joining us today. And are there any other final words that you would like to share with our listeners about Sufism and about your work in Sufism?
Well, one of the things that we have created, and I'm very happy that it continued, was the Sufism Symposium that we celebrated its 20 years of anniversary. And it still continues. And of course, it name changes from Sufism Symposium to the Songs of the Soul Festival. And this time we have Songs of the Soul Festival in April 9th, which is going to be in San Rafael, Marin County. And another program that we have developed is the Women's Wisdom, Women in Action, a series of the lectures by the women leaders who are in this area. And that is going to happen in March 5th, and it's still in San Rafael, Marin County. I am also participating in the organization of a conference in Egypt that is also in March, of women from around the world who have changed their communities and their societies for betterment.
Are you paying particular attention to the engagement of women in Sufism? I don't know the history of women in Sufism, but we hear a lot about the role of women in other branches of Islam.
Well, Sufis, there's a little bit difference between all these roles. There have been Sufi teachers since the beginning of time, of the life of Sufism. And these Sufi women have their students. But cultures always play such an important role in the writing the biographies of these Sufis. Somehow they disappear, sometimes they become the footnote in another Sufi man and master, and ultimately, it goes back and forth. There have been great many Sufi teachers in Sufism, women, and one of the things that I was able to do was in the first Sufism symposium that we had, in the central circle, that main circle that usually men Sufi masters sit, I actually sat on that circle. And I also led a zikr that everybody would repeat. So that was the beginning of the whole change in the actual presence of the Sufi women in the very secluded circles that were reserved for our Sufi men.
Very good.
And from then I was able to actually, bring and organize and make sure that it happens that our Sufi women stand side by side by our Sufi men.
Right. Very good.
And I wanted to mention, Phil, take it from there, the International Association of Sufism, people can look that up at just simply IAS.org. So that's the website, IAS.org. Go ahead, Phil.
I was going to ask Nahid to mention that because people may want to know more about Sufism and maybe explore the teachings on a local level. How would they go about finding more information, or are there Sufi centers or mosques throughout the country?
There are many Sufi teachings. If you are thinking about the United States, there are many Sufi teaching centers around in the United States. And in our area, there are also Sufi centers. And one of those Sufi centers is ourselves, because other than, being an international association of Sufism, we also have our own school of Oasi Sufism. And we have our center, Khanegah, which, Khanegah is a Sufi temple, that Khanqa actually means that the house of time. So there are many Sufi centers in the United States and also in California and mm-hmm. in the Northern California and also ourselves.
I have one last question. Can somebody learn the meditation that you practice and not be a Sufi, not be Islamic, be Christian, be Jewish? The practices that you have for mysticism, for mystical experience, are they available only to people that belong to the religion or for anyone?
For anyone.
Very good.
Well, if it was, in my personal opinion, if it was another banner that would limit people, then why it becomes like universal? No,
right.
It should be open to all.
Right. Which is a hallmark of Sufism. It's been great to have you on the show and to educate people about the tradition. And once again, the website is IAS.org,
yeah.
International Association of Sufism.
And I recommend you go to that site because I've been to it, and there's a tremendous amount of information and really laid out very clearly and practically. And I think so, something we'd all like to learn more about. And Nahid, thank you so very much for your time coming on with us. I learned a lot.
I appreciate. Thank you so much for the invitation, and thank you so much.
Very good. Thanks.
Have a good day.